Good evening, everyone. We acknowledge that the lands on which we are hosting this meeting include the traditional territories of many nations. The CFPC recognizes that the many injustices experienced by the Indigenous peoples of what we now call Canada continue to affect their health and well-being. The CFPC respects that Indigenous people have rich cultural and traditional practices that have been known to improve health outcomes. I invite all attendees to reflect on the territories you are calling in from as we commit ourselves to gaining knowledge, forging a new culturally safe relationship, and contributing to reconciliation. Nous reconnaissons que les terres sur lesquelles nous tenons cette rencontre regroupent les territoires traditionnels de nombreuses nations. Le CMSC reconnaît que les nombreuses injustices subies par les populations autochtones de ce que nous appelons maintenant le Canada continue d'avoir un impact sur leur santé et leur bien-être. Le CMSC respecte le fait que les peuples autochtones ont des pratiques culturelles et traditionnelles riches dont les bienfaits sur la santé sont reconnus. J'invite tous les participants à songer au territoire où vous vous trouvez présentement, alors que nous nous engageons à acquérir des connaissances, à forger une nouvelle relation culturellement sécuritaire et à contribuer à la réconciliation.
Anyone can participate in research. It's not scary, it's actually really a cool and exciting thing to do.
Family physicians are some of the nicest people I know who care about their patients and their communities.
I don't know of any family physician who don't want to do the best they can for their patients. And research is a tool that we can use to do a better job.
But it's really in practice that we do the best research.
Nous, on s'intéresse à des aspects qui ne sont pas couverts dans d'autres recherches, comme par exemple, comment on peut accompagner le patient.
In a holistic way, grounded in culture, the community actually drives the questions that I work with.
It's extremely important to bring an idea or a perspective to the community and help shape them in forming what the research will look like.
When I look back, I see that there was opportunities to improve not just my practice, but the overall health of my community, and research has allowed me to do that.
We can lead some of the most impactful trials in medicine in our offices with little or no impact on workflow.
Maintenant, on est des leaders, j'en suis convaincue, de savoir comment on intègre le citoyen, la citoyenne, le patient, la patiente dans la méthode de recherche.
It's not pie in the sky. We're doing it now.
Welcome, everyone, to our virtual celebration honoring our research award recipients. Bienvenue. For those of you who do not know me, my name is Marshall Godwin, and I'm chair of the section of researchers at the College of Family Physicians of Canada. Like many of you, I was hopeful that we would be able to celebrate in person this year, but here we are again, and I'm hosting this celebration for the second year from my home in St. John's. While we can't gather together in person, we will do what we always do as family physicians and researchers, which is to do the best we can with the tools we have. As a discipline, we're a resilient bunch, and the pandemic has shown how true this really is. We have seen how family physicians were able to radically adapt and pivot their practices in an ever-changing landscape. We have also seen primary care researchers step up to the plate during the pandemic to investigate new and emerging questions arising out of COVID. This was very evident to me as I had the honor of adjudicating the submissions for the COVID-19 Pandemic Response and Impact Grant Program, also known as CORIG. This innovative program was created by our own Foundation for Advancing Family Medicine with a $5 million contribution from the Canadian Medical Association Foundation. CORIG focuses on supporting innovations designed to help family physicians and their teams tackle challenges related to the pandemic. The family medicine research community saw what needed to be done, and with the support of CORIG funding, They did not waste time in seeking out the answers to many new questions that have arisen due to the pandemic. Be sure to read about the lessons learned through these innovation projects and the interactive report that was created by the foundation with the support of the section of researchers entitled Advancing Family Medicine During the Pandemic, CORIG Phase 1. We have inserted the link in the chat. At least I hope it's there, or someone will be putting it there. Tonight, while we celebrate the extraordinary work of primary care researchers in this country, let us continue to reflect on how our work can address health and social inequities, which have been exacerbated even more so by COVID, and how the work we do contributes to better health for our patients and the communities we serve. As a reminder, much of this work is supported through donations. As you know, the foundation holds the annual end-of-year campaign during the Family Medicine Forum, and like every year, we appeal to all of you at this event to raise funds for research initiatives and research awards. Last year, your generosity broke all annual records, and we raised over $13,000 during our evening celebration. We hope you will help us set another record tonight. And for good reason, your donations will support the development of the Blueprint Initiative Research Fund, inspired by the Section of Researchers Blueprint, in support of research that targets the care delivered through family medicine primary care practices. Through the Blueprint Initiative Fund and with your generous donations, we will support at least one family medicine primary care researcher who is dedicated to advancing critical action items in the SOR Blueprint. That will start in 2022 with funding support for research on patient engagement and for studies that advance practice-based research networks. Please put your donations behind this important goal. I will get it rolling with my own gift of $500 this evening. I invite you to give what you can, and thank you so much for what you do give. To contribute this evening, please follow the links provided in the chat. So there will be links put in the chat that you can click on to go to the donation page. And hopefully that link is being put there as we speak. I don't know. Before I introduce my fellow hosts, I would like to remind you of the chat feature on Zoom. Take the opportunity to greet one another, congratulate our award recipients, and generally celebrate with us the advancements in family medicine research. Also, we are hosting an SOR after party at the end of the award ceremony. The Zoom link will be posted in the chat for you to click into the virtual room. Join us to chat and catch up with your peers and friends. Last housekeeping note before we get the show on the road, we want to see how you are celebrating tonight. Please strike a pose, maybe a glass of wine or something like that, and send us a picture of how you are celebrating. You don't have to worry about driving home, so, you know, the glass of wine, I think, is quite appropriate. Send a copy of your picture to research@cfpc.ca. That's research@cfpc.ca. Between now and 7:30 p.m. Eastern, to be featured in our celebration slideshow. If you're on social media, tag us with hashtag section of researchers and hashtag myFMF or hashtag monFMF for French. Okay, so joining me this evening to celebrate our research award recipients are Dr. Francine Lemaire, CEO and Executive Director of the College of Family Physicians of Canada, Dr. Catherine Chervin, the CFPC President, and Dr. Jeanette Boyd, Chair of the Foundation for Advancing Family Medicine. And I'm going to turn it over to Francine now. Francine.
Thank you, Marshall. Merci, Marshall. Bonsoir et bienvenue à tous. Il me fait plaisir d'être ici ce soir et de célébrer avec vous les réalisations en recherche en médecine de famille au cours de la dernière année. Nous ne sommes pas capables de nous rassembler en personne. Néanmoins, il est important de souligner le progrès remarquable qui a été accompli. One year ago, vaccines were still in development, and now they are widely available in Canada to those eligible. While we will be living with COVID for some time, we're hopeful that by continuing to apply public health measures where required, we will be able to broaden our interactions and activities soon. As a discipline, we also have grown so much in the past year, in no small part due to the exceptional research and quality improvement efforts by researchers like you. The video that played at the beginning of our celebration really brings this message home. We must nurture a culture of curiosity as family doctors to continually strive to improve the health of our communities. La vidéo diffusée au début de notre célébration fait vraiment passer ce message. Nous devons entretenir une culture de curiosité en tant que médecins de famille afin de nous efforcer continuellement à améliorer la santé de nos communautés. Many of you already know that I will be ending my tenure as Executive Director and CEO of the CFPC and FAFM at the end of June 2022. So tonight is the last time that I will attend this event in my current capacity. As I reflect on the evolution of primary care research over my years at the college, I'm amazed and humbled by the tremendous growth and accomplishments and contributions you have made. Family medicine in Canada is better and stronger as a result of your incredible efforts and dedication. For this, I want to thank you, and I have every confidence that your leadership and quality work will continue to shine in the years ahead. I'm pleased to join Marshall with my donation of $500 to support the implementation of the Research Blueprint Initiative. Our president, Dr. Kathy Chervin, we'll now say a few words. Kathy?
Thank you, Francine. Bonsoir et bienvenue à tous. Good evening, everyone. And it is wonderful to gather together with all of you to celebrate and honor your accomplishments, plural. I too have been amazed by the research community's ability to shift course throughout the pandemic and focus on new emerging clinical questions as they arise. And this was particularly evident to me when reading the recently released report from the Foundation's COVID-19 Pandemic Response and Impact Grant Program, which describes these incredible projects addressing a range of critical issues facing family medicine teams and communities across Canada during the pandemic. I thank all of you in attendance tonight and everyone in this section of researchers for your contributions to primary care research, particularly now during these exceptional times. I have added my donation of $500 to Marshall's, and I encourage you to do the same. Thank you for your remarkable commitment to advancing scholarship in family medicine. And please turn your attention now to Dr. Jeanette Boyd, Board Chair of the Foundation for Advancing Family Medicine.
Thank you, Kathy. I'm delighted to be here with you tonight. Today, we celebrate excellence in research, over 25 years of your commitment and excellence in family medicine research. Félicitations. The Foundation is proud to support family medicine research as a critical building block of a robust medical discipline. We are living through a period of great change. It is now more important than ever to strengthen family medicine and primary care through research. When I look at the extraordinary contributions made to family medicine over the last year, I am confident that together we are making positive strides. It is the hard work of family medicine researchers that improves patients' experience, enhances population health, and contributes to the work life of family physicians. Over the past 2 years, the Foundation has focused on expanding the CFPC's capacity to fund research initiatives that are responding to emerging needs. These dynamic times have provided a unique backdrop for strategic partnerships and advances in family medicine research, motivating the investigative work over the last year into a family medicine research entity and, of course, the CORIG program. CORIG is a powerful example of what we can achieve together as a family medicine community. Phase 1 just wrapped up and phase 2 projects are getting underway. The foundation also designated $100,000 to the Bridgewater Center for Global Family Medicine to fund comparable pandemic-related initiatives in family medicine research in South Africa and Indonesia. I would like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the generous donation of $5 million from the CMA Foundation that made CORIG possible and the guidance and support of the section of researchers. Thanks also to everyone who supported the CORIG project as members of the steering and adjudication committees and to the CFPC Research Department for supporting the development of the final report for CORIG Phase 1. And a special shout out to all the family medicine teams leading the innovative CORIG initiatives. And speaking of FAFM-led initiatives, we are here tonight to celebrate the recipients of awards that are part of the FAFM Honors and Awards Program. Moving forward, there are many more research initiatives that the section of researchers, with the support of the foundation, is set to pursue. You know what's coming next? I want to ask you for your support. As part of the annual opportunity to collect more resources to invest in programs for CFPC members, we hold the annual end-of-year campaign. Marshall described our goal to establish the Blueprint Initiative in support of research on patient engagement or practice-based research networks. Tonight's goal is to raise $15,000. Every dollar raised by FAFM supports family medicine. And we do this thanks to the generosity of individuals like you, CFPC members, volunteers, members of the public, and charitable and corporate partners who understand and appreciate the value of family physicians. We have made it easy for you to donate from your home on FAFM's secure donation page. The link to donate is posted in the chat. To designate your gift to research on the donation page, please select Family Medicine Research. I will add my gift to Marshall and Francine and Kathy's donation, and I invite you to do the same to get things started tonight. Please give generously. Research is the future of family medicine. And I'm so delighted to say that we have raised $2,100 so far. Thank you.
Excellent. And thanks so much to Francine, Kathy, and Jeanette for your words and for your donations. We appreciate it. All of the awards that we will be presenting tonight are part of the Foundation for Advancing Family Medicine's longstanding honors and awards program, made possible through the generosity of its donors who believe in the work that we do as researchers. The first awards we will acknowledge tonight are the Research Awards for Family Medicine Residents. These awards recognize family medicine residents in their first or second year of training for excellent research they have carried out and completed. The first award goes to Dr. Bridget McDonald from the Northern Ontario School of Medicine for her project, The Use of the Pictorial Representation of Illness and Self-Measure, PRISM, as a clinical tool and its potential use in addictions medicine, a qualitative evidence synthesis. Dr. McDonald presented her findings today at the Family Medicine Forum. Our second research award for family medicine residents goes to Dr. John Thompson from Dalhousie University for his paper, A Closer Look at Maternity Care in Fredericton, New Brunswick, a qualitative study exploring the motivations of women seeking midwifery care. Dr. Thompson also presented his findings today at the Family Medicine Forum. Congratulations to both of you. Congratulations. The next award is for the CFPC Outstanding Family Medicine Research Article. This is awarded to the author of the best research article published in a national or international journal during the preceding year based on original family medicine research. This year's recipient is Dr. Karen Chan for her and her colleagues' paper titled P peer umbrella systematic review of systematic reviews, management of osteoarthritis in primary care. Dr. Chan presented this work today at the Family Medicine Forum. Congratulations to Karen and to her co-authors. Congratulations. So now we move on to the Canadian Family Physician Best Original Research Article Award. And this award recognizes the best article published during the preceding year in the Canadian Family Physician that was based on original research. Congratulations to Dr. Anita Srivastava for her and her co-author's paper, Long-Term Treatment Outcomes in a First Nations High School Population with Opioid Use Disorder. Dr. Srivastava also presented this work at the forum today. So, congratulations again to our first few award recipients, and thank you to the Foundation for Advancing Family Medicine for making these awards possible.
Bonsoir, les amis. Merci pour vos dons. I'm delighted to report that we've raised $700 so far tonight. This is a great starting point to solidify the Blueprint Initiative Fund and to advance family medicine research. Thank you. And please keep donating. The FAFM donation page is posted in the chat. Don't forget to select family medicine research when you make your donation. Thank you and merci. And now we're in for a bit of a magical surprise. Take it away, Brent and Sarah.
Hello, everyone.
Hello, everybody.
And welcome to our part of the show that yes. features two magicians, uh-huh. as well as incredible magic.
What?
And spontaneous applause from the audience.
Whoa. Oh, so spontaneous.
Thank you. Yes.
Amazing.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Now, the man standing next to me is my husband, Brent. And although it may not look like it, he is a magician. Sure, he may not be wearing a stylish top hat, be a normal height, or way much more than a teenage ballerina.
Is there a but?
No, not much going on back there either. Hey! However, when it comes to magic, Brent doesn't need to perform miracles like turning water into wine. No, no, his needs are simple. He turns champagne into pure, straight Jägermeister.
Cheers!
Hey, oh! Woo! Yeah. Okay. And just like that, folks, he's over his limit.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you very much. I'd now like to address the elephant in the room, my wife, Sarah.
Wait, what? That's not what we said we would
say. No, that's an expression.
Right.
You're not an elephant. She's,
no.
She's not the elephant.
Right.
It's just because she's a female magician.
Sure.
Which is not the most common thing in this line of work,
okay.
right?
Right. Right. Yeah, right. Sure.
But the magic Sarah performs is actually a step above most men, right? Like, not only can she make objects like that champagne bottle magically disappear with a wave of her hand, but even more impressive, she can magically bring it back.
Hello.
Yeah. Now you see it.
Yes.
Now it's gone.
Hey, magic. Everyone loves it.
Not buying it?
Not buying that.
No.
Okay.
To be honest, we were just testing your attention span and
that's true.
Really your sobriety to see if you
true.
Would buy that.
Yeah.
I mean, honestly, if Sarah could actually make that champagne bottle disappear, it would be gone for good.
Just like that. Okay.
Let's hear it for Sarah.
Hey. Everybody, thank you.
Yes, Sarah, it is true. Elephant in the room is not the correct term.
No,
no. But being a female magician is a rare thing, and Sarah got started in a unique way. You see, when she was getting started in magic as a young girl, she didn't start with her magic kit in her bedroom or a deck of cards at school. No, she performed her first magic trick in a small aluminum boat in the middle of Lake Erie. This is where Sarah's grandfather used to take her boating, fishing, and disposing of evidence. He was an interesting guy. It was also the place where, as she grew a bit older and grew more compassionate, she started to consider what it might be like to be a fish. You know, swimming through the water without a care in the world until all of a sudden a big metal hook rips away at the inside of your mouth. So basically, 12-year-old Sarah didn't like that idea very much. In fact, the more she thought about it, the more she thought she didn't want to go fishing at all, but she did love spending time with her grandfather, so instead of canceling the fishing trip, she thought it might be better to make her grandfather's fish hook somehow disappear. Now, she thought about throwing it overboard, but was worried it might hit another fish on the way down. Then, she thought about hiding it in her grandfather's lunch bag, but was concerned he might find it while reaching for his sandwich. Eventually, she decided that if she was really going to make that fish hook disappear, she would have to put it in the one place her grandfather would never, ever find it. Her stomach. And just like that, the fish hook was gone, but as every good fisherman knows, you must always bring along a spare. And because Sarah's grandfather was the overprepared type, he always had a spare to his spare. And then, of course, there was his favorite hook. And the hook he was given by his grandfather. And his grandfather's grandfather. And when all those options were exhausted, even an extra hook hidden away just in case his granddaughter Sarah somehow lost hers in the first place. And because he was just a really overprepared dude, he had three extra hooks hidden in the bottom of his fishing tin at all times just for emergencies. Okay, the point is he had a lot of fish hooks. And Sarah's grandpa, he looked everywhere, searching high and low throughout that entire boat. But thanks to Sarah, he never found a single hook. Instead, the two of them sat in that aluminum boat and talked all day long. They got to know each other better. Sarah even got to hear her grandfather's full life story and all about how he broke out of prison and met his secret second family. It was at that point she had realized she had gotten into the wrong boat and that the man she was with wasn't even her grandfather at all. Still, they had a wonderful time in the lake and a beautiful day together. Later that night, however, while Sarah was getting ready for bed, she started to think about what she had done, and she started to consider what tomorrow morning might look like, particularly the type of horrific bowel movement that might await her. So she decided she needed to do something about the pesky fish hooks hidden in her stomach. What she did.
Ta-da!
Sarah!
Hey, thank you! Thank you very much.
This is a classic story of two people fishing together in the most ordinary way.
I'm sure you've heard it all before.
Yeah. Before we go any further, I do feel the need to clarify that, yes, obviously, parts of that story were embellished for your enjoyment. It is important and only responsible to note that Sarah was in a fiberglass boat, not an aluminum one. I think that's about it. But you're probably sick of looking at us in this screen. We'd like to spice things up with our magic show. After all, we are performing from the den of our condo, which is not as exciting as you might think, but Sarah's setting up some magic in the kitchen right now that you're gonna love. Take it away, Sarah.
Hello, and welcome to Magic in the Kitchen. I am your magical host, and today I am joined by my best friend, and also my husband.
Hello there. Today's trick uses nothing but a glass and bottle. We call it the glass and bottle trick.
Yes, although in truth, we do also use these two tubes. So I guess we could call it the two tubes glass and bottle trick.
I guess we could.
Uh-huh. Now, the aim of the trick is to make the glass switch places with the bottle. And in order to do that, we use these two tubes.
And another bottle, apparently.
Yes, because today I thought it would be so fun to perform the two tube glass and two bottle trick.
So fun.
Yeah. Now, as I was saying, the aim of the trick is to make the glass switch places with the bottle.
No, she means one of the bottles.
Yes, of course. To make the glass switch places with one of the two bottles. We'll use this one. Now, the first thing we do is take the two tubes and place them over top of the glass and the bottle. Then I take my hand and make a magical pass over top of the bottle. It goes like this.
Then I do the same to the glass. It's important to note that you don't actually have to do any of that. We just found that it helps wake up anyone who may have nodded off during our show. Anyway, just like that, the glass and bottle should have magically become the bottle and the glass.
But just to be sure, let us check. Yes. Yeah. Both the bottle and the glass have switched places, but that wasn't even the amazing part. The amazing part is when we make them switch back. Okay, well, we didn't say it was a good trick.
Right, but it is. It is. I mean, it's just hard to believe it until you actually see it.
Yes, audiences do love that part. Like, they love it a lot.
Thank you.
Yeah, they love it.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ooh, but they also particularly love when we make them switch back.
Hey-o!
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now, when switching the glass and bottle.
Two bottles.
Right, when switching the glass and two bottles, it's always important that we use and reuse these two tubes whenever we choose to. It's the only way to switch the glass and bottle.
Two bottles.
Right, two bottles. And these tubes also show everybody at home that there's nothing funny going on, because as you can see, there's just two empty tubes and a glass and two bottles.
Three bottles, actually.
Right, well, yeah, and that's why we sometimes call this trick the two tubes glass and three bottles trick.
Yes, of course.
All right, let's begin, shall we?
Let's.
My tube goes over the glass, which immediately becomes the bottle.
And my tube goes over the bottle, which immediately becomes the glass.
Of course, the only way that would work is if you had an extra bottle, in which case you would need four bottles, and that's why the real name for this trick is the two tubes glass and four bottles trick.
We should have mentioned that earlier.
Yeah.
It's also important to mention that if you only had one tube, you could single-handedly go from glass to bottle and bottle to glass, so long as you had an extra bottle and started calling your trick the two tube glass and five bottles trick.
Right, or if you wanted to get fancy, you could even crisscross those two tubes to make the glass and bottle switch places. Then to continue the two tubes glass and five bottles trick, you would simply return those tubes to their original positions to perform the two tubes glass and six bottles trick.
Yes, now furthermore, with those six bottles.
No, that's seven, actually.
Indeed, with those seven bottles, it is always important to ensure that the glass and one of those seven bottles are covered by the two tubes when performing the two tube glass and seven bottles trick.
That's the whole reason these two tubes exist in the first place.
Yeah.
Now, if you wanted to switch your seventh bottle.
No, that's eight.
Sorry, I mean, if you wanted to switch your eighth bottle, you would just need to start calling your trick the two tubes glass and eight bottles trick.
Right, and if you found that you had too many bottles, you could always remove one of those bottles, but then, of course, you would still have an extra bottle, and now your trick would be known as the two tube glass and nine bottles trick.
Right. Other magicians perform the two tubes glass and nine bottles trick, whilst farmer magicians perform the two tubes glass, nine bottles, and an egg trick, but only Brent and Sarah perform the egg, two tubes, nine bottles, and two glasses trick.
And then we raise those two glasses and to give a cheer.
And make that wine magically disappear.
Nice.
Thank you for joining us for Magic in the Kitchen. Remember to stay tuned after the show for our segment called Magic in the Bedroom.
Brent! Okay, welcome back. Thank you so much, everyone. Thank you for joining us for this part of the show. We want to encourage you to keep donating and make sure you just stick around because...
After the show, we're going to be doing an after party, of course, and it's more of an interactive thing where there's a real focus on mind reading. We're going to actually read some people's minds through the screen.
Hello.
It doesn't work if there's not people there, so please come back and join us for that. At this point, we'd like to turn things back over to Marshall. Enjoy the rest of your night. We'll see you soon.
If only they could make COVID magically disappear. Oops. Just a second. I need to be unmuted or something. Nope, I'm okay. I got a message, but they must have fixed it. Anyways, yes, magically make COVID disappear is what we need. Anyway, if you enjoyed that, You're going to love the live and interactive magic show. They mentioned it from Brent and Sarah. That's going to happen in our Zoom after party right after this event. So you remember that and sign up to the after party. That's when you can get your wine and drink and things then as well. Anyway, speaking of magic, there's a very magical member of the CFPC research team who is retiring at the end of this year. Yes, you may have chosen to not believe the rumors, but it is true that our very own Jamie Jensen, Research Department Coordinator Extraordinaire, will be retiring after 28 years of service to the CFPC. Jamie has shown a true dedication to the family medicine research community and the section of researchers since its inception 26 years ago. Jamie, your research colleagues and friends have some special messages for you. Take it away.
Hi, Jamie. I was here thinking, and then I started thinking about you, and I was thinking, you know, Jamie is going to retire, and we're really going to miss her. And we're especially going to miss your cookies, although we haven't been able to have them for a couple of years. But you've been the historian of our institution, the person who recalls things from decades ago, and we're going to miss that. But I certainly hope you have a wonderful retirement and enjoy a well-deserved prolonged vacation, let's call it.
Hi, Jamie. I wanted to wish you a wonderful retirement from my backyard. I was hoping that Jax would actually be part of it, but remember when you're retiring from a job, it's not like retiring from your family. And there are some of us who have become almost like family over time. I feel very honored to be one of those people, and I wish you all of the very best as you move forward with your new positions of being a grandparent, reading more, and being able to actually get out to the lake more. Anyway, thinking of you lots, and enjoy the rest of your time. Never settle for the path of least resistance. Living might mean taking chances, but they're worth taking. Loving might be a mistake, but it's worth making. Don't let some helping heart leave you bitter. When you come close to selling out, reconsider. Give the heavens above more than just a passing glance. And when you get the choice to sit it out or dance, I hope you do.
Dear Jamie, what to say? I'm very happy for you. It takes courage for making the decision to retire, but it is at the same time so exciting. Of course, I will miss you as a person, as a colleague with an incredible memory, as an excellent coordinator. But it is your kindness that I will miss the most. And maybe a little bit of your brownies. This is now your time. I hope you will enjoy every minute. I wish you all the best. Take care, Jamie.
Hey, Jamie, I heard the bad news. You're retiring? Oh, no. We'll miss you. Seriously, though, you have made a huge contribution to the section of researchers, one which I personally have benefited from, experienced. I've loved working with you. Your warm personality, your calmness, your efficiency, so many things, not to mention the cookies. Jamie, you'll be missed, and I hope that you really enjoy your retirement, which is so well deserved.
Congratulations, Jamie, on a well-earned and well-deserved retirement. Thank you so much for all your support.
Congratulations on your retirement. So well-deserved. I feel very privileged to have known you all these years. Many fond memories from the brownies at SOR meetings to just all the warm greeting that you gave me when I first became involved with SOR and, you know, doing that joint SOR-SOT symposium at FMF. Thanks so much. And I really hope you enjoy your retirement. Enjoy those summer camping trips. Maybe they can be a little bit longer now. So all the best. Wishing you well. Bye now.
Hi, Jamie. Big congratulations on your decision to retire this year. I started in family medicine research back, I believe, 15 years ago. I think it's exactly 15 years ago. And what between yourself and Viv Ramsden, you were the two first people that I met in family medicine research beyond the walls of the University of Manitoba. And thereafter, I always equated you with all things research associated with the College of Family Physicians of Canada. And saw that you were just a pivotal person to make things happen, and yet always out of the spotlight too. So while you were acknowledged at NACCREG a few years ago, that was wonderful, but you've always very quietly went around doing your thing. And a few years ago when I was the FMF research chair, you took me by the hand and you guided me through that entire process. And I'm sure you've done that for multiple people over the years. And that's probably been key to the success of Research Day at FMF. So now it's your time. Now go enjoy those sons of yours and be the grandma. Go to Banff, see your son, let him take you on all kinds of mountain tours. Enjoy your retirement, stay well, be healthy. It's been a pleasure working with you and take good care.
Jamie, I can't believe this is your last FMF as a CFPC employee. We're going to miss you so much, but we are so excited for what lies ahead for you.
Hi, Jamie. It was a great pleasure working with you. I will miss you a lot. We could always count on you, and this time count of us, we are coming to visit you.
Congrats, Jamie. You made such an amazing contribution to the CFPC. Good luck on the next chapter of your life.
Jamie, it's been so wonderful working with you in part one of our careers decades ago, and now since I rejoined the CFPC back in 2020. I'm watching all of these fabulous video tributes to you. You are a legendary maker of cookies and brownies, and obviously I missed that in between our working together, but not as much as I'm going to miss you, Jamie. I'm going to find out where you are and get some of those cookies and brownies. Have a great retirement, Jamie.
You inspire me, Jamie, to always stay passionate. You are irreplaceable, great to work with, and wishing you the best.
Hi, Jamie. I've learned a lot working with you. I'm really going to miss you. Thank you. Congratulations, Jamie.
Happy retirement, Jamie.
That was a lovely tribute. And yes, Jamie, you will be missed. But we know we are saying so long for now and not goodbye. I'm sure we'll see you around. We may even have to come visit you. And I forget where it is you're going. You told me, but it's gone. Next, I would like to congratulate the recipients of the Family Medicine Resident Awards for Scholarly Achievement. This award recognizes outstanding academic accomplishments by family medicine residents and are intended to stimulate family medicine research and innovation in education. One recipient or team from each faculty of family medicine across Canada is selected. Congratulations to our winners. So, University of British Columbia, Dr. Kate Elliott, and Dr. Irfan Rajani. University of Alberta, Dr. Avery Winnick.
University of Calgary, Dr. Anastasia Bosk. University of Saskatchewan, Dr. Sarah Penny and Dr. Alexandra Pistori. University of Manitoba, Dr. Aaron McCullough. Western University, Dr. Daniela Karen. McMaster University, Dr. Serena Arora, Dr. Tony Lee, Dr. Jennifer McAllister, and Dr. Peter Zhang. Northern Ontario School of Medicine, Dr. Alana Rawana Barron. University of Toronto, Dr. Sejul Doshi. Queen's University, Dr. Andrew Dawson. University of Ottawa, Dr. Evan Batten. University of Montreal, Dr. Genevieve Arsenault. McGill University, Dr. Annie Pierre Duguay, Dr. Ina Ermechuk, and Dr. Serena Lala. Laval University, Dr. Maud Boucher, Dr. Marianne Lemire, Dr. Xiao Ying Yang, and Dr. Lawrence La Liberty. Dalhousie University, Dr. Jonathan Craig. Memorial University, Dr. Lawrence Rue. Our next award is the Nadine Sampier Award. I would like to invite Francine to present this award en français, s'il vous plaît.
Merci, Marshall. Comme les autres prix, le prix Nadine Saint-Pierre fait partie du programme des prix et bourses de la Fondation pour l'avancement de la médecine familiale grâce à la générosité de ses donateurs. Le récipiendaire de ce prix est sélectionné parmi toutes les candidatures francophones proposées pour le prix d'érudition pour les résidents en médecine de famille. Le prix Nadine Saint-Pierre souligne le meilleur travail d'érudition par un résident en médecine de famille francophone exceptionnel au Canada. Cette année, la récipiendaire de ce prix est la Dr Geneviève Arsenault pour son travail d'érudition intitulé « Les technologies de rappel aux patients favorisent-elles le dépistage? » Avant de choisir de faire ses études en médecine, Dr Geneviève Arsenault a effectué un baccalauréat en droit et a été avocate pendant un an. Aujourd'hui résidente de deuxième année en médecine de famille à l'Université de Montréal, elle contribue déjà énormément à la recherche en médecine préventive dans le cadre de ses travaux d'érudition. Dr Arsenault a commencé son parcours en recherche durant ses études de premier cycle en tant que stagiaire à l'Institut de recherche clinique de Montréal. De 2017 à 2019, Dr Arsenault a travaillé auprès d'Impact Santé, une organisation qui fournit des services de premiers soins d'urgence lors d'événements sportifs. Elle a d'ailleurs fait partie de l'équipe qui représentait le Québec à la compétition de premiers répondants tenue lors de l'International Trauma Conference de 2018 à Saint-Louis, au Missouri. Non seulement son travail présente des pistes d'amélioration des soins préventifs en médecine de famille qui sont centrés sur le patient, mais il tient compte du potentiel des technologies telles que le dossier médical électronique et des barrières qui risquent de nuire aux stratégies de rappel. Son manuscrit a remporté le prix de la Revue de la littérature 20021 lors de la 18e journée de la recherche et de l'érudition du programme de médecine de famille de l'Université de Montréal. Félicitations, Dr Arsenault.
Alors, je m'appelle Geneviève Arsenault, je suis présentement en deuxième année de résidence en médecine familiale à l'Université de Montréal. Je travaille à la clinique universitaire de médecine familiale Notre-Dame. En fait, je me sens vraiment très touchée d'être récipiendaire cette année. Quand est venu le temps de choisir mon sujet de projet d'érudition, j'avais le désir de sélectionner un sujet qui allait faire avancer la médecine familiale puis qui allait améliorer nos pratiques. Donc, je suis vraiment très reconnaissante de voir que cette initiative-là, elle a résonné dans la communauté médicale, puis qu'elle a intéressé plus d'une personne. Mais je pourrais commencer par remercier toute l'équipe de la clinique de médecine familiale où je travaille, qui ont vraiment été aidants dans la réalisation de mon projet. Surtout Dr Pless puis Dr Castonguay qui ont été très présents puis très dévoués là, dans la réalisation du travail, qui ont pas gênés pour donner des commentaires très constructifs là, dans la réalisation. J'aimerais aussi avoir un faire une petite mention spéciale parce que la première fois que j'ai présenté mon projet d'érudition, c'était quelques jours avant le décès de mon père, qui était en soins palliatifs. C'était un moment difficile, mais je pense qu'il il a veillé sur moi puis il m'a épaulée là, dans tout ça. Donc, je suis d'autant plus reconnaissante de recevoir ce prix-là. Puis, il y a probablement une petite partie qui lui revient là, entièrement.
Congratulations. Thank you, Francine, and congratulations again, Dr. Arsenault. We now have another short video on quality improvement in family medicine. Hope you enjoy it.
Many family doctors are already doing quality improvement and have been doing so for a long time. They have just not referred to their efforts as QI.
Quality improvement, or QI, can be done in any practice setting. It can be inspired by the work we do every day. The ideas and leadership for QI can come from any team member, and we don't have to wait for others to tell us what improvement needs to be done.
The curiosity and the commitment to improve lives, the altruism that is a part of being a family physician, continually asks us, what are we doing and how can we be doing it better?
Family practice can be so busy, and sometimes one of the hardest things is to find time to stop and reflect and think about how we can do better. For us, one of the turning points in being able to improve quality of care in our practice was starting to hear directly from patients and working with them to come up with solutions to make things better.
L'amélioration continue réunit un peu tous les joueurs importants. C'est toujours mieux d'apprendre en équipe et avoir les collègues autour de la table.
Data is really important to help us know what we're doing well and what we're not doing well. And without input and meeting with each other, we often don't do it. And this helps improve the community doctor's practice and develop skills at all levels.
And quality improvement and research gives us the tools and the ways of thinking, of approaching it. How we can improve the experience, not only of patients, but also of ourselves as healthcare providers.
To me, this is better care.
It's now my great pleasure to announce this year's recipient of the Lifetime Achievement Award. This award recognizes family medicine researchers who are the trailblazers and leaders in family medicine research and who have made a significant career contribution to the discipline. This year's recipient is Dr. Rick Glazier. Dr. Rick Glazier is a family physician and a pioneer in research of primary care health service delivery. Over his career, he has significantly impacted how we think about population health and what we can do collectively to improve access to high-quality care for everyone. Not only has Dr. Glazier brought clarity to key issues such as enhancing care delivery for underserved populations, he's also helped build capacity in primary care research. He has helped foster nascent research training programs, encourage young physicians to pursue their research interests, supervise graduate students, and mentored countless faculty. As the scientific director at the Institute of Health Services and Policy Research at CIHR, he has more opportunity to cultivate, support, and enhance the Canadian primary healthcare research community. Recently, he worked closely with the CFPC and FAFM on development of the COVID-19 Pandemic Response and Impact Grant program, CORIG, that you've heard so much about so far tonight. Dr. Glazier is also professor in the Department of Family and Community Medicine, the Dalai Lama School of Public Health, and the Institute of Health Policy Management and Evaluation at the University of Toronto. He is a family physician at the St. Michael's Hospital Academic Family Health Team and is a scientist at the MAP Center for Urban Health Solutions at St. Michael's Hospital. Dr. Glazier holds an MD from Western University and completed his residency in family medicine at Queen's University. He received a Master's of Public Health at Johns Hopkins University and completed his residency in General Preventive Medicine and Public Health at Johns Hopkins University and the World Health Organization. The CFPC has previously awarded Dr. Glazier the Family Medicine Researcher of the Year in 2005, and he was recognized as one of the top 20 pioneers in family medicine in 2015, and the W. Victor Johnson Award in 2016.
Hello, my name is Rick Glazier. I'm a family physician. I work at St. Michael's Hospital Academic Family Health Team in Toronto as a clinician. I'm a health services and policy researcher, both at St. Michael's Hospital, at the University of Toronto, in the Department of Family and Community Medicine, and at ICES, the Institute for Clinical Evaluative Sciences. I am incredibly honored just somewhat overwhelmed, I have to say, about being awarded the CFPC Lifetime Achievement Award. This is an award that comes from my peers, and there's no more important or informed group about what you do than the people you work with all the time. Your peer group is by far the most important one. And for me, it's just an absolute incredible honor knowing the many thousands of worthy family physicians, members of the college across the country, and the amazing contributions that they're all making. This is just an incredible honor for me. My journey through the college has been an interesting one, and I have to say that I feel a very close family connection and affiliation with the college. The late 1990s, for several years, I chaired the Honors and Awards Committee. And there's a certain irony in my receipt of this award, because this is an award that I championed for many years, along with Inez Graba-Gubbins and others at the time. We encountered a lot of resistance establishing these kinds of awards, I have to say. And I was just delighted that they happened. I'll finish just by a few thank yous. I have so many people to be, so much gratitude. It's very hard. I'm sure I'm going to leave super important people out. My wife, Sherry, and my family are by far the most important supports. It's been an amazing journey, and without them, then and now, I could not have done it. My early career mentors, Moira Stewart, Walter Rosser, were unbelievable in their continued support, even to this day, in advancing my career. And I think they're my role models for helping to mentor and advance other people. My local leaders in family medicine, especially Philip Berger and Karen Wayman, have been incredible mentors and leaders. And my research mentors at ICES, and Andreas Lapakis, David Henry, Michael Schull, and many, many others have been incredible. And my many family medicine research colleagues around the country, far too many to name. But I find myself in when you have a grant competition or whatever, you have to declare your conflicts. I think I'm just in conflict with just about every family medicine researcher in the country, and that just reflects how privileged I've been to work so broadly with everyone. So I just want to end by thanking the college, thanking the peers who nominated me for this award. I do feel a bit old getting a Lifetime Achievement Award. I guess that's the only downside, but just very humble, very grateful, and want to thank you all. Bye-bye.
And again, congratulations, Dr. Glaser. It's well deserved. Now is the time for one of the most anticipated awards of the evening, our Family Medicine Researcher of the Year Award. This prestigious award recognizes a family medicine researcher, CFPC member, who has made original contributions to research and knowledge building for family medicine in Canada. The contribution encompasses any aspect of family medicine research, from clinical to health services to education research. This award has been designed to honor a family medicine researcher who has been a pivotal force in the definition, development, and dissemination of concepts central to the discipline of family medicine. It is my great pleasure to announce our Family Medicine Researcher of the Year Award to Dr. Kevin Potty. Dr. Kevin Potty is passionate about global health and uses research and entrepreneurship to drive a global movement of evidence-based care for vulnerable populations. He has led a disruptive and productive 20-year research program in primary care, focusing on refugee health, health equity, and interdisciplinary evidence-based guidelines. Throughout his career, Dr. Potty has helped guide and shape national and international practice and policy related to primary health care. As co-lead of the Ontario Ministry of Health Primary Care Transition Fund, Impact Project, he developed a popular interdisciplinary healthcare delivery model that has enabled primary care practices to integrate clinical pharmacists. During the refugee health crisis, Dr. Potty led the European Center for Disease Prevention and Control team in the development of the European Migrant Health Guidelines, and working with the World Health Organization, he integrated grade evidence and equity into decision-making processes. He now co-leads the implementation of international e-COVID plain language recommendations. Dr. Potty currently holds the Ian McQuinney Chair in Family Medicine Studies at Western University, where he is a professor in the Department of Family Medicine. He is also an active adjunct professor in family medicine, epidemiology, and community medicine at the University of Ottawa and Dalhousie University. He completed his medical degree at Dalhousie University, his family medicine residency at the University of Ottawa, and earned a master's in clinical science at Western University. Inspired by his patients around the world, Dr. Potty says his work aims to contribute leadership, entrepreneurship, and scholarship to community and family medicine.
Yes, my name is Kevin Potty. I've practiced family medicine in emergency rooms, rural hospitals, humanitarian missions, community health centers, academic teaching clinics, and long-term care homes for the past 27 years. Well, it's my passion to connect with people, and this is what really drives me. But this peer recognition is a wonderful bonus. My career pathway has been into the depths of global health and primary care, and it's not easy for many to understand this. So I actually want to acknowledge my many peers in this area of social accountability, and I really want to thank them for their leadership, because I think this award for me is recognition that means we can all stick to our knitting. My family medicine experience and my humanitarian work has helped me develop the skills to meaningfully connect with people from around the world. When I'm able to really understand, I think, the essence of another person, and when they actually can feel this, I believe we connect. And it's within this connection, maybe with a person seeking asylum, a person without a home, or an elder living alone, we both profit. And I believe it's at this moment that my real work as a family doctor begins. So my next big step in my career is to attempt to scale this experience with digital health pathways. The COVID-19 pandemic has magnified health inequities around the world. And really, inequities are my work. The pandemic has allowed me to engage in research to improve long-term care, address newcomers working in meat processing plants, develop a new refugee health network and guidelines with my refugee health peers, and provided me with an opportunity to translate COVID-19 recommendations from around the world for the public and practitioners. Certainly, it's been a very difficult time for all of us, and especially certain people, but this has actually, I think, given real true meaning to my work. First off, I'd really like to acknowledge my father. I think has played an amazing North Star leadership role in my life. And I'd also like to acknowledge colleagues, Bill Hogg, Peter Tugwell, and Janet Hatcher-Roberts. I believe we all do our work, you know, with our peers, and this is what makes it most useful and most meaningful. So I'd like to thank them and many others.
Congratulations, Dr. Patti. Cher collègue, for the last fundraising update of the evening, tonight you have helped us raise $9,100 and we're well on our way to our goal of $15,000. Thank you for your generous support. Merci beaucoup. The Foundation for Advancing Family Medicine is proud to support you, the family physicians of today and tomorrow, in your primary care research initiatives. Your work and passion for research is what will continue to allow family medicine in Canada to advance and flourish. If you would like to make a donation to the current campaign, please do so through the FAFM website by December 31st, and visit the website during the year for updates on more initiatives of the foundation. And please give generously. Your research is the future of family medicine. Merci.
Thank you for joining us to celebrate and acknowledge our amazing award recipients, as well as for your generous gifts to the SOR this evening. It's not too late if you haven't been able to get to the chat feature and click on that link to donate. We've got 9,100, I think, but you know, we're hoping to get to 15. So if you can find it in yourself and you haven't done that yet, well, think about doing it. The link will be there, hopefully, right through the after party. I hope someone will keep it there in the after party. Anyways, I know it's not the same being together in person, but as always, we made the best of it. And take a look at the photos sent from this evening. Remember, I asked you to take pictures and send them in. So I guess what happens next is those pictures get put up and then Francine will provide us with some final housekeeping notes. And then we'll see you at the Zoom after party.
Congratulations once again to all our award recipients. Félicitations à tous. Thank you everyone for coming here tonight, for tuning in for our celebration. It's inspiring for us to witness your continued engagement and ability to celebrate. I'd like to remind you that our keynote tomorrow begins at 9:55 Eastern Time. Dr. James Makokis will give an address entitled Doctoring the Spirit, Healing with a Stethoscope in One Hand and Sweetgrass in the Other. Finally, join us in the Zoom after party, which will start in a few minutes, and the link to join the party is or will soon be posted in the chat. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Congratulations, everyone.
Congratulations. See you in a minute.